My name is Dr Sarah Laurence. I'm a lecturer in the School of Psychology and Counselling. Today I'm delighted to be joined by Professor Cathy Mondloch. Cathy is a professor in psychology in the Department of Psychology at Brock University in Canada. She is the director of the Face Perception Lab and is a world-leading expert in face perception. So, Cathy, I'd really like to hear more about some of the research that you've been working on. I'd like to start by asking you why it is important to study our ability to recognize faces.
That's a great question, Sarah. I think it's important for several reasons. First of all, we really take for granted perhaps our ability to recognize faces. And yet that ability is critical for everyday social interactions. If you talk to somebody who's poor at this, they'll tell you that oftentimes they might walk right past somebody that they know, and that person will determine that they're unfriendly, when in fact they just were unable to recognize the face. So for something as basic as greeting people on the street, this ability is important. And I think the fact that we are quite good at this, at least for faces that we do know, is made us all quite comfortable with using photo ID in a variety of settings, such as buying age-restricted goods or perhaps crossing the border or boarding a plane. And yet, it's actually quite difficult to match identity across different images of somebody. And so, understanding the kinds of errors that people might make and the conditions under which we make errors is really important on that basis. And I think the other reason is some people actually struggle with this ability. So, there are individuals who are really poor at this. And if we can understand how most people accomplish the task, perhaps we'll be able to help those folks.
So the fact that we seem to be better at recognizing faces we know shows that experience with a specific person, be it your family member or some familiar person, is important.
Correct.
Is there any evidence that more general experience with faces matters?
Yes, and this is the sort of thing that our lab is really, really interested in. I think there are three lines of research that suggest that experience with faces more broadly influences both our ability to perceive identity in people we don't know and our ability to learn new faces. Perhaps somebody you meet at a party one evening. And one line of evidence that this does not come from our lab is that people who grew up in very, very small towns, less than 1,000 people, so they're exposed to a very small number of different faces on a daily basis, tend to make more errors than people from large towns when they're asked to decide whether two photos belong to the same person or two different people. So this suggests that the number of faces you have experience with influences your ability to recognize them, which is quite interesting. Another line of evidence, and of course, this is work that you've been very much involved in, is that it takes a long time to become good at recognizing faces. So, for example, if you ask children to take a pile of photographs and put those photographs look at each picture in that pile and decide whether each photo belongs to the person on the front of a toy house. If that person on the front of the toy house is unfamiliar, children make many more errors than adults do. But their ability to do this task improves between about 6 and 12 years of age. So, presumably, as they're getting exposed to more faces, they're getting better at this ability. And what's really interesting is that very young children, and again, this is work that you've been involved in, who are just 4 and 5 years of age, children who've had much less experience with faces, actually make errors even if that photograph on the front of the toy house is a picture of somebody they know very well, such as their own teacher. So this suggests that it takes a lot of exposure to faces, many, many years, before we reach adult levels. Now, you might think, well, that's just because they're children and they don't pay attention very well. But the third line of evidence that suggests that experience more broadly matters is that around the world, we find that people are much better at perceiving identity in what we call own race faces, which is just a term meaning faces that have different physical appearance by virtue of country. So, East Asian faces as compared to white faces. And if you ask people around the world to recognize faces, we're all better with own race faces than we are with other race faces. And this begins during infancy. And so what it suggests is that the kinds of faces to which you are exposed shapes your brain so that you become really good for that face category and struggle for other categories. And we see something very similar based on facial age. So most people are much better at recognizing young adult faces than they are at baby faces or older adult faces. And again, this is probably experienced broadly rather than with any one particular face.
So moving forward, what do you think are the main questions that still need to be answered?
There's so many interesting questions there. I think the very strong influence of familiarity, the fact that it's really, really easy to recognize. I know you quite well, so I'm going to be able to recognize you in lots of different photos where you varied your makeup and hairstyle and lighting and point of view. But somebody who doesn't know you is going to really struggle with that. So I think what we need, we've started on this, but what we as a whole scientific community need to understand better is, how are we representing faces of people we know? What is it that we're storing? Are we storing some kind of average of how that person's looked across all of these exposures? Or are we storing the kind of variability to which we've been exposed? We need to learn more about that. And I think we need to learn a lot more about the process by which we learn a face. Even from an applied perspective, if we need to be able to identify certain people, how can we best enable people to learn that face so that they'll be able to recognize it later? And I think another really interesting question for future research is, to what extent is this thing we're looking at specific to faces? So I think quite a lot about this, and I think, well, you know, there's not many things we need to recognize at an individual level. So recognizing Sarah from David from Mike, but the other two instances where that I think is the case, one for sure is language, right? You need to recognize a word, even when it's spoken by different people under very different acoustic conditions. And you need to discriminate that word from other very similar words, which sounds to me very much like recognizing people. And the other system that's like that is music, where you have to be able to recognize a melody even when it's played by a different instrument or at a different tempo. So I think a really interesting question is to step back from any one system and just add broadly in these three social systems that have been, you know, with humans for a very long evolutionary period of time. Are we using the same mechanisms to learn? And we can learn from each other. So I think, you know, as scientists, this world we're living in now where we can share information very easily, this movement towards open science where we're posting raw data files and stimuli will allow the kind of collaboration that we really need to answer what I think are very important questions. We need communication between computer scientists and psychologists and all other groups in order to really understand. To me, those are two really big questions. And of course, understanding development, which is really one of my focuses, contributes to that, because studying children is like breaking the system down and looking at it at its very earliest stages, which is like taking a clock apart, right, to understand how it works. So I think those are some of the big issues.
Cathy, thank you so much for joining me today. It's been fascinating listening to you talk about your research. And thank you. Thanks once again.
Well, thank you for inviting me, Sarah.